Topic of our presentation is Administration of Justice in Mughal Era. I will introduce this. Introduction. 712 में जब मोहम्मद बिन कासिम ने इंडिया फतह किया तो मुसलमानों की एक बड़ी तादाद इंडिया में दाखिल हुई। ये छठे उम्मे खलीफा अल वलीद बिन अब्दुल मलिक का दौर था। ताम कुछ हिंदू शहजादों और मुस्लिम रियासत मदीना के दरमियान ताल्लुकात का अंदाजा दूसरे खलीफा हजरत उमर रज़ियल्लाहु अन्हु के दौर से भी लगाया जा सकता है। जब इनके दौरे हुकूमत के शुरू में तरनदीप यानी इंडिया से एक वक्त आपसे मिलने आया था। हिंदुस्तानी साहिल ने बहुत से मुस्लिम ताजों को अपने इलाकों की तरफ रागब किया, जैसे कि मालाबार। 15 ईस्वी में मुस्लिम रियासत ने आज के जो बलोचिस्तान और सिंध के इलाके हैं वहां पे मुहिम भेजी। 21 ईस्वी में मुसलमानों ने मकरान को फतह किया। शिमाल में गजनी के महमूद बिन सब्तगीन ने पंजाब के एक बड़े हिस्से पर कब्जा किया और इसके बाद शहाबुद्दीन गोरी ने पंजाब को खिलाफत से मुंसलिक किया। 1192 CE में मुस्लिम कमांडर शहाबुद्दीन गोरी ने दिल्ली को अपनी तहवील में ले लिया। कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक ने 1206 में दिल्ली सल्तनत की बुनियाद रखी। अगरचे इब्तदाई तौर पर कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक ने दिल्ली को अपना हेडक्वार्टर बतौर वायसराय बनाया था, उस वक्त इसका शाही मास्टर शहाबुद्दीन गोरी था, लेकिन बज़ाब्ता तौर पर दिल्ली की सल्तनत 1206 में वजूद में आई जब वायसराय इनके शाही आका की वफात के बाद दिल्ली का पहला आजाद सुल्तान बन गया। 1206 में मुसलमानों की पहला जो शाही खानदान था उसने इंडिया में रूल किया, उसे स्लेव डायनेस्टी कहते हैं। इसे स्लेव डायनेस्टी इसलिए कहा जाता है क्योंकि यहाँ के जो बादशाह थे वो यहाँ तो गुलाम थे या फिर गुलामों के बेटे थे। ये जो स्लेव डायनेस्टी है ये 1206 से 1290 तक रही, जब इसके बाद दूसरी मुस्लिम डायनेस्टी यानी खिलजीज ने इंडिया में पावर इख्तियार की और इस तरह ये सेकंड मुस्लिम डायनेस्टी बन गई। खिलजीज ने 1290 से 1320 तक इंडिया में हुकूमत की। इसके बाद तुगलक यानी इन्होंने खिलजीज को शिकस्त दी और इस तरह तुगलक थर्ड मुस्लिम डायनेस्टी बनी, जिन्होंने 1320 से 1414 तक इंडिया में हुकूमत की। तुगलक को बाद में सैयद ने शिकस्त दी 1414 में और फिर इसके बाद ये बंद हो गया। सईद जो है 1414 में इन्होंने तुगलक को शिकस्त दी और इन्होंने फिर 1414 से 1415 तक इंडिया में हुकूमत की और ये फोर्थ मुस्लिम डायनेस्टी थी। फिर इसके बाद 1454 में लोदीस ने सैयद को शिकस्त दी और ये फिफ्थ मुस्लिम डायनेस्टी बन गई। लोदीस 1454 से 1526 तक इंडिया में रहे। फिर इसके बाद इन्हें जहीरुद्दीन बाबर ने 1426 में शिकस्त दी और इस तरह जहीरुद्दीन बाबर जो है ये सिक्स मुस्लिम डायनेस्टी बनी, जिन्होंने 1526 से 1707 तक इंडिया में रूल किया। जहीरुद्दीन बाबर की डायनेस्टी को मुगल डायनेस्टी भी कहा जाता है। अगरचे मुगल डायनेस्टी 1857 तक कायम रही, लेकिन ये औरंगजेब आलमगीर की वफात यानी 1707 के बाद तकरीबन ख़त्म हो गई। इसीलिए आज हम जो जुडिशियल सिस्टम का जिक्र करते हैं वो ज़्यादातर जलालुद्दीन अकबर और औरंगजेब के जुडिशियल सिस्टम का करते हैं, क्योंकि कहा जाता है कि इनके दौर में जो सल्तनत थी वो अरूज पर थी। ताहम जब इनका जिक्र हो तो नूरुद्दीन मोहम्मद औरंगजेब की कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन को इग्नोर नहीं किया जा सकता। अकबर और औरंगजेब मजहब के अतबार से मुख्तलिफ थे और इन्होंने मुख्तलिफ पॉलिटिकल मॉडल्स को मुतारफ़ करवाया। अकबर ने अपने नए ऑर्डर तरीकत में एक हाइब्रिड क्रिएट किया जिसमें इसने हिंदुओं को सकाफती और मजहबी तौर पर कुछ अकोमोडेशन दी, लेकिन बाद में इस मॉडल को रिजेक्ट कर दिया गया। अकबर और औरंगजेब के जुडिशियल सिस्टम तकरीबन एक जैसा था। अगरचे बादशाह खालिस तौर पर मजहब से मुहब्बत करने वाले थे, लेकिन वो खुद को ऐसा नहीं समझते थे कि वो सिर्फ अपने मजहब के लोगों के हकूक का ख्याल रखें और दूसरी कम्युनिटीज को इग्नोर कर दें। इनके दौर में तमाम कम्युनिटीज के दरमियान बैलेंस कायम था। द नेक्स्ट इज जुडिशरी अंडर अकबर।
नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस जुडिशरी अंडर अकबर। मुगल एम्परर्स ऑफ दैट पीरियड रूल्ड थ्रू डिक्रीज एंड फरमान्स। The Sultan was the chief executive, the sole legislator, and the chief judge. So all these three powers were concentrated in him. Next is the privileges that were granted to Hindus during Akbar era. Number one, the killing of cows were forbidden in Akbar era. Early in his reign, he abolished jizya, which is also called as poll tax. Number third privilege that was granted was the appointment of large number of Hindus on responsible posts and Hindu cases to be decided by Hindu judges and not by Muslim qazis. What is Akbarnama? Secretary of Akbar, Abu Fazl, wrote Akbarnama. Akbar was under his great influence. He was the champion of heterodoxy. So Akbarnama could also be called as Akbar's new cult or order, Tariqat, in which he deviated a lot from orthodoxy. Akbar also innovated a new religion called as Deen-e-Ilahi. There is a lot of controversy about this. Some historians argue that Akbar had probably innovated a new cult or order, but not a new religion. Now, I'm going to discuss the greatest contributions of Akbar. Hindu subjects were the main beneficiary from Akbar's scheme. The greatest contribution of Akbar include, number one is the systemization of revenue assessment to a country whose sole industry was agriculture. Number two is the introduction of zavity system through which Akbar levied fixed tax which was fair to the peasants and also ordered that the price of each variety of grain had to be determined each season. He also divided the whole country into 119 dastoors called as assessment circles. According to this, the piece of land in various dastoors had to pay fixed amount which depended upon the area and the quality of the land. What was the conflict between Akbar and Qazul Qaza? The Qazul Qaza was the chief justice and his name was Abdul Nabi. This conflict occurred because of Abu Fazl, who was the secretary of Akbar. The conflict was that the Qazi of Mathura had ordered the construction of a mosque. A Brahmin Hindu removed the construction material out of hostility to Islam. So for this, the Brahmin was summoned to the court. The Brahmin did not only abuse the court, but also used abusive language for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. The local Qazi informed the chief justice who summoned the Brahmin. So the Brahmin was found guilty of blasphemy. As a result, the Brahmin was sentenced to death by Abu Nabi. Since all the capital punishments need to be approved by the emperor, so the Qazul Qaza submitted the case to Akbar for his confirmation and orders. As Akbar was deviated a lot from orthodoxy, so he refused to execute the guilty. In addition to this, the influential Hindu officials also requested Akbar on behalf of the Brahmin. Akbar ordered a secret inquiry and gave this task to inquire the facts of the case to the opponents of Qazi. Inquiry, however, confirmed the charges. Even then, Akbar was reluctant and ordered Abu Nabi not to execute the man. Qazi, however, pressed for execution, and at this point, Akbar couldn't find a way out, so not clearly giving the orders and leaving the matter to Qazi. Akbar did so because he was too cautious to take the responsibility of setting aside the decision of the court. The Qazi executed the man. As a result of all this conflict and execution of Brahmin, Akbar dismissed all the existing Qazis and the appointment to the highest judicial and religious post was only on one condition, that they will adhere to Akbar's religious philosophy. Moreover, the grants of religiousness were cut down and gradually old recipients of grants were totally eliminated. Despite of all this, the judiciary by and large still functioned freely.
I am going to discuss Mahdar Mazhar. The heterodox ulama gathered around Sheikh Mubarak, the father of Abul Fazl, to play a trick that would make Akbar an emperor of highest legal authority. Sheikh Mubarak drew up a document to which leading ulama of court were forced to affix their signatures. The document was called Mahdar. It is important to note here that different authors have spelled Mahdar differently. Mitchell called it Mazhar. Its main purpose was to establish that if jurists differed on point of law, Akbar would decide what interpretation he would enforce. It was basically an assembly of ulamas that supported Akbar. they got together, discussed the issue, and agreed that in case of their disagreement on the question of Islamic law, Akbar would decide the issue. Then the result came. The scheme did not succeed as much because no situation has been reported in which the ulama had differed to such an extent that Akbar had to intervene personally. Abul Fazl painted and propagated the image of Akbar as supreme dispenser of justice. Next is Jharoka-e Darshan. The most visible manifestation of emperor's role in judicial affairs was the valuation of Jharoka-e Darshan. It was common to 6th and 7th centuries. It is an Hindu institution innovated by Akbar to facilitate public appearance. An example of Muslim Indianization. Next, Sulahul. In general, Mughal emperors were impartial and stern in delivering justice to their subjects. According to Abul Fazl, His Majesty in his courts make no difference between relatives and strangers and no distinction between a chief and a tangled hair back there. Akbar gave death sentence to a powerful military chief of Gujarat for the murder of one Chinggis Khan on the complaint of mother of deceased. Akbar's judicial policy seems to be partly motivated by humanitarian principles of Sulah-ul, which is basically a Persian phrase, which means peace with all, and partially to reassure the Rajput nobility serving in Mughal court. Next, Jahangir. The second most important emperor after Akbar and before Aurangzeb to mention is Jahangir. He ascended throne in 1605 and his first order was fastening up for the chain of justice so that if those engaged in administration of justice should delay or practice hypocrisy in the matter of seeking justice, the oppressed might come to this chain and shake it so that its noise might attract others. Following this, he issued 12 ordinances, varying from banning of river toll fees to prohibition against facial disfigurement. Whenever he periodically shifted his royal court, one of his first order was to have temporary judiciary built in the new city. He did this in Ajmer and Ahmedabad, and he used to hear civil and criminal case every week. He took equity before law so seriously that after hearing how the governor of Punjab, Saeed Khan Chagatai, was ruthlessly extracting revenue in his area, the emperor sent him a message that my justice would not put up with the oppression from anyone, and that in the scales of equity, neither smallness nor greatness was regarded. If after this, any cruelty or harshness should be observed on the part of his people, he would receive punishment without favor. He also deplored murder committed by the nephew of Khan Alam, Hasheng, and when he was found guilty, the emperor had him executed. He was very particular about granting the rights of minorities. In 1608, he issued firmans to governor, officials and jagirdars of province of Gujarat and ordering them to safeguard the temples and dharamshalas of Jain community. He ordered them not to levy taxes on pilgrims visiting Tirtha of Yatrunjaya.
Judiciary under the reign of Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb was orthodox in his religious philosophy. He was strictly adheres to his religious beliefs. Under the rule of Aurangzeb, courts were extremely independent. In this matter, Aurangzeb did really well because judiciary was completely free out of any kind of discrimination. He was well liked by the Muslim population because of his orthodoxy. Aurangzeb turned out the secular policy of Akbar. Now, how he turned out the secular policy? His elder brother, Dara Shikoh, was leader of heterodox and was accused of apostasy. He also translated many books on Hindu philosophy. To conclude, he was another Akbar in making. So the special tribunal of jurists ordered his execution and he was executed. In this way, Aurangzeb Alamgir tried his best to turn out the secular policy of Akbar. The great work he did in his time and that is still praised today is Al-Fatawa-e Alamgiriya under the Royal Commission of Ulama led by Sheikh Nizam. Aurangzeb ordered Al-Fatawa-e Alamgiriya, which was a documented Islamic law book, and it became the foundation of legal system of India during the reigns of Aurangzeb and later Muslim rulers. It was also considered as corpus juris. Corpus juris means a book that collects all principles of laws. until the fatwa replaced by fiqh firoz shahi, which was considered the basis of judicial system under Delhi rulers, written by Ziauddin Barani at the time of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Coming to the legal reforms introduced by Aurangzeb Alamgir. Aurangzeb Alamgir introduced a series of legal reforms, some of which survive to this day in both Pakistan and India. The first reform he introduced was a system of remand. Remand, which is a process of detaining a person who has been charged with an offense until his trial. The Kotwals were ordered to obtain a written order from the Qazi to keep a man under custody for the purpose of investigation. Second reform. He took particular notice of the delay in the disposal of cases and issued directions that all criminal cases must be tried without any delay. If after the first date of hearing, the case was not taken up, the next day, Kotwal was required to send the prisoners daily to the court till matters were decided. The term which is also used to say this, haroz anjab farsande ke mamla rab istajale faisle numayan. Third reform. He issued a firman that no one was to be taken into custody until prima facie legal evidence was available against him, and that no person was to remain in jail without any lawful charge. The term which is used for it is haq kasbe behisab dar qaide namadan. It is said that it is mere a coincidence that when Aurangzeb was issuing this reform, British Parliament was enacting Habeas Corpus Act for England. Fourth reform. Aurangzeb wanted transparency in administrative as well as in judicial matters. And in this regard, he directed the record keepers of state that public have a right to examine the performance of officials. Fifth reform. For the first time in the reign of Aurangzeb, wakils were appointed to defend suits against the state in every district. They were known as wakil-e-sarkar or wakil-e-shara. They used to receive a fee of rupee 1 daily, and they had to give free legal advice to the poor. These wakils were appointed by the chief qazi of the province or sometimes by the qazi al-guzar. Sixth reform. Aurangzeb had framed written regulations, which is known as zabat, on every subject and required strict adherence to them. It is said that besides fifth fatwa-e alamgiriya, this sixth reform also count as his great achievement, as his great work. Seventh reform. Aurangzeb also reformed the appeal system. He issued orders that parties should get their disputes decided by the local qazi in the first instance before bringing their cases to him. These were the great reforms introduced by Aurangzeb Alamgir. Next thing is mazhar namas or record of judgments. Mazhar namas were the record of judgments of higher courts for the circulation among the qazis and the muftis. Only a manuscript named Waqi'us As-Salihat, which contains 50 judgments during that period. The manuscript called Waqi'us As-Salihat contains record cases from the Mughal era. Every case describes the facts and the reasons for the decision. This manuscript, Waqi'us As-Salihat, is available at National Museum, Karachi. Some authors have mentioned that Mughal qazis were very corrupt, but it is difficult to believe their assertions because Manoki, a European, and Khafi, they had recorded their account, and they also praised the independence and the impartiality of Mughal's judicial system.
I'll discuss here the court personals and the hierarchy of the court at the Mughal era. So before going to work, the court structure and its personals, it's important here to discuss the central government of Mughals. So in the central government of Mughals, the head was emperor. He was also the commander in chief of entire army and navy. He also used to have the council of ministers. The most influential minister among those was Vizier. He was like modern prime minister. Other ministers approached the king through him. There was a Diwan-e-Ala. It was the most important post in the capital. It was for revenue, finance, and agricultural department, and was also the final court of appeal for the revenue cases. Mir Bakshi was for the military administration, salaries, and accounts. And the chief justice's responsibility was to the administration of justice and of jails, customs, Baitul Mal, and Masjid. The other notable ministers were Darogha-e Topkhana, who was the Master General of Ordnance, Darogha-e Dak, he was the Postmaster General. Mir Sama, he was the Lord High Steward for the Imperial Household. The next was Sadr Sudur, he was in charge of Ecclesiastical Department. And there was a Chief Muhtasib, who was the Chief Public Prosecutor in the state cases and was the Chief Censor of Morals. So, let's now discuss the hierarchy of judicial system. So in the hierarchy, the first court was Diwan-e-Muzalim, second was the court of Qazi-ul-Qaza, third was the provincial chief court, and the fourth and last was the district court. Now we'll discuss the personnel and the function belonging to these courts. So the first one is Diwan-e-Muzalim. Its head was emperor. In that Mughal era, the categories of cases were civil, criminal, and political. Criminal and political cases were decided by Khalifa. In civil and criminal cases were decided by the Qazi. In that era, political and administrative cases were sometimes secular. And they were described as Nazar fil Muzalim by Fiqh. Fiqh means Muslim jurist. So they attained a policy that was called Siyasa Sharia, according to which these Muslim jurists expounded the Islamic legal system that was fixed and left the flexible legal system of Islamic history that was flexible and was changing according to the need of Muslim community. They left this flexible part to the Imam. Both Akbar and Aurangzeb devoted one day for the cases that, and they sat at Diwan-e-Muzalim. On that day, they directly came from the window to Diwan-e-Khas and sat at the throne of justice. In that hall, judges, muftis, kotwal, perfect city police, superintendent of law court, and muhtasib were present. The emperor, after hearing the grievances from the plaintiff and after ascertaining the facts, took the consultation from the muftis and pronounced the judgment accordingly. The jurisdiction of this court was extended to the original civil and criminal cases. As an appellate court, he presided over the bench consisting of Chief Justice Qazi of the Chief Justice Court and decided both question of law and fact. As a court of first instance, he had the assistance of Darogha-e Adalat, Mufti Mir-e-Adal. Also, all the capital punishments were required to be confirmed by the emperor. The second court is the court of Chief Justice or Qazi-ul-Qaza. The Chief Justice was appointed by the emperor. The functions of this court included administration of oath of accession to the sovereign, to order the khutbah or the Friday summon to be read in the emperor's name in the mosque in order to give the validity to his accession. He was appointed by the emperor. He had the power in his jurisdiction was extended to the all civil and criminal cases. Also, he had the power to take the appeals from the provincial court, and he also supervised the working of provincial courts. The personals attached to this court were Darogha-e Adalat or Darogha-e Kachahri, Mufti-e Azam or Sadr-e Jahan, Muhtasib. Also, there was a Diwan-e-Ala, which I have discussed earlier, that it was the final court of appeal for the financial cases. The next court is Court of Provincial Chief Qazi. There was a governor for each province. He was a court of appeal for the revenue cases within the province. When he was absent due to any reason, he appointed a Diwan to temporarily act as governor. The judicial department was under the provincial chief Qazi. He was the head of the province and was appointed by the Qazi, and he was called Qazi-e-Suba. His jurisdiction was extended to the original civil and criminal cases. He was also the chief court of appeal in the province, hearing the appeals from the district Qazi. The persons attached to this court were the Rogai Adalat, who used to receive the application filed in each court. He was also sometimes known as the Rogai Kachari, a Mufti whose job was to give legal opinion but not to give judgment. Mufti was attached to the Chief Justice Court was known as Mufti-e-Alam or Sadr-e-Jahan. There was a Muftasib who was attached to the capital and his who was a prosecutor in the canal laws. There was a Mere Adal who was the administrative officer to assist the court. The very important post in the capital was Diwan-e-Alam, which was for financial cases. There was also a Mufti Pandit Swan and Vis Vakyanigar. Besides the court, there was an office of Diwan-e-Suba. He was to assist in the revenue and the financial cases. There used to be a staff that included Peshkar, Daroga, Treasury, Tahvildar. And the clerical staff attached to his court was Munshi, Zur Clerk, Suba Clerk, Clerk for Crown Lands, Record Keepers, Accountant, and Hurdle. The next court is the court of District Qazi. For each Sarkar, there was a Qazi. The jurisdiction of this court extended to the civil and criminal cases, and also to take took the appeals from the courts situated in the district. The functions of this court were to inquiry of offences, to visit the jail and inquiry into the cases of prisoners confined therein, collection of zakat and jizya, leading the Friday or Eid prayers, attending the important funerals, seeing the solemnization of Muslim marriages. His staff included the Peshkar, a Khatib. Khatib had to record the proceeding given by the dictated by the Qazi. There was a Sahibul Majlis who was to read or the dispositions of witness in the court. There was a Nazir who was the in charge of court building in the menial establishment, Daftari, who took after the stationery and book binding. There was a Machalkanali who took the bond of attendance from the parties or the witnesses. Some of these posts still exist in the Indo-Pak subcontinent. There was a Darogai Adalat, Mere Adal, Mufti, Pandit, Shastri, Muhtasib, Vakil-e-Shara. It is important to discuss here that there was a Vakil-e-Sarkar who was appointed as a full-time lawyer in the district. They were attached to the court of district Qazi and received a fee of 1 rupee per day. They had to give the free advice to the poor free of charge and to conduct the suits on the behalf of state, and to get the state's decree executed. That's all.
So it's my turn to explain officials with some judicial functions. There were some other officers related to, but not direct part of the judicial department of the Mughals. The first such officer was the Sadr, who was in charge of ecclesiastical department in the district. He was appointed by Sadr-us-Sudur, and his duties included checking of the sanads of qazis, muhtasib, khatib, imams, muezzins, and mutawallis, issuing of parwanas for the daily stipends of officials and ulemas in the city and other towns, and passing bills for payment to charitable endowments. His
judicial functions were limited to settlement of claims relating to Madde Mosh grants or sitting on a bench with district Qazi to try canal law case, there used to be a Fauzdar whose judicial functions, including trying petty offenses, later on his powers were enhanced. Kotwal was another officer who was subordinate to district Qazi and had jurisdiction in minor offenses. Another official was called Amal Guzar, who decided rent and revenue cases. To his court was attached a Drogai Kachari. Waqe Nigar or Waqe Navis or Akhbar-e Navis recorded proceedings of the court mentioned above on day the emperor. These reports were scrutinized by Qazi Paragna. He was the principal officer in the Paragna. Paragna means town. His jurisdiction extended over the villages, including in his Paragna. His powers were similar to the district Qazi. However, the former could not hear appeals as there were no subordinate courts to him. A number of officials were attached to his court. They include a Mufti, a Mohtasib-e Paragna, a Drogah-e Adalat, and a Wakil-e Shara, who had a staff of 3 clerks and 1 accountant. In some Paragnas, there used to be a Fauzdar-e Paragna who exercised the same powers as the district Fauzdar. A few districts had ameens or revenue officers, while in other places there were no Fauzdars at all, and their duties were performed by Shikdars or Kotwals. Sometimes the local landlords were appointed in Paragnas to try common law cases and appeals from their courts lay to the district Qazi's court. Karorai and Amin-e Paragna used to decide revenue cases in the Paragna. The last one is Panchayat. The early sultans retained the system in which a village used to have a council of elders called Panchayat. These Panchayats were very active. The punishments took the forms of public humiliation, fines, and ostracism. The last punishment had serious social and economic consequences, especially in a caste-based society. Hence, the orders of the Panchayats were invariably obeyed. Those elders held their sittings in public and administered justice in the village in case involving petty civil disputes or where minor offenses were concerned. The decision of Panchayat were binding and normally no appeal was allowed. The decrees were generally executed. The headman or the chaudhari was usually the head of the Panchayat and had to maintain peace and security in the village. However, the name of the head differed from region to region. In the east, the chaudhari was called the Mukaddam, in the west the Patel, and in the south the Shetty. Its main functions were the settlement of disputes, matrimonial, communal differences, land, quarrels concerning watering of fields, and sharing of produce were settled by the Panchayat. The legal relations between the non-Muslim subjects of the Muslim rulers in India were regulated according to the principles of their own faith. In disputes between a Muslim and non-Muslim, the decision was given according to Islamic law. When the case was between two Hindus, it was referred to the judgment of Pandits. Under the later Mughals, subordinate courts were established in many of the sub-districts presided over by a Naib-e Qazi. The Mughal judicial system was simple and served the needs of people. All capital cases had to be approved by emperor, while all the important civil cases were also brought to him. Qazi. Serious criminal cases came under the jurisdiction of Qazi, and the Qazi was the chief judge in criminal cases and tried them according to Islamic law. Cases between Muslims as well as cases in which one of the parties was a Muslim was tried by him, and the Qazi in each sarkar had the power to appoint their assistant or Naib-e Qazi in important center. In each sarkar, the Kotwal performed many duties. He acted as a prefect of the police and municipal officer. Secular type of criminal cases went to him. The Mufti was a learned theologian and consulted books on Islamic law regarding disputes and advised the Qazi who pronounced the sentence or decision. It appears that each and every Qazi consulted a Mufti. Thank you.
With the great name of Allah, I would like to start my presentation. So, assalamu alaikum to all of you. Now, I would like to discuss some other officers that are not directly part of judicial department of the Mughals. And the first one is Mir Adal. He was junior to Qazi. There was an officer responsible for discharging the executive duties of the court. The Mughals called the officer as Mir Adal. Now, coming towards the duties of Mir Adal. Number one, he used to draw the attention of the Qazi to a miscarriage of justice and to delay the execution of some decisions pending trial before a higher court. Number two, he used to make sure that the parties and the witnesses attending the Qazi court and that the decrees of the court were executed. Abul Fadl, Akbar's secretary, has summed up in Ain-e-Akbari the relationship between Qazi and Mir Adal in a nutshell. He said, one finds out and the other puts into effect. Now I am coming towards the second officer, that is Qazi Askar. Under the Mughals, there was a separate Qazi for the army, known as Qazi Askar. Basically, he was a senior member of a royal court. He supervised judicial affairs, heard legal cases, oversaw legal matters of the military administrative personnel, and handled campaign duties. Now moving towards the jurisdiction of Qazi Askar. Number one, in a case in which one party resided in the jurisdiction of Qazi Askar and the other in that of the Qazi of the city, and the latter insisted on having the case tried in the city court, the Qazi of the army could not try it unless he had been specially empowered to try all such cases. Number two, if both parties belonged to the Askar and wanted to take their case to the city Qazi, they could do so, and the city Qazi had the power to entertain it. What is clear from this is the fact that there was no difference as far as the content of the law or its application was concerned. The city of the Qazi, as well as the city of Qazi city of the military camp, they were appointed under the same law. Number three, there could be civil cases in which two individuals were involved and not a case involving discipline within the army or breach of army code. Now I am coming towards my last officer, that is Muhtasib. The Muhtasib is basically empowered to award compensation to those who suffered loss or damage as a result of maladministration and ensure that no wrongs were done to citizens. One of the most important institutions of Mughal Empire was that of Hisba, means an institution of accountability, under which Muhtasibs were appointed. The Abbasid as well as other Muslim rulers who ruled the Delhi Sultanate also had the same institutions. All Muhtasibs were appointed under the Sadr al-Sudur. Now, who is Sadr al-Sudur? He was in charge of ecclesiastical department and known as Chief Muhtasib. He was the chief public prosecutor in state cases and was also the chief censor of morals. Now, what are the responsibilities of Muhtasib? The Muhtasib was theoretically responsible for the maintenance of Islamic code of morals and behavior. There was no overlapping between the duties of Qazi and a Muhtasib. The Qazi had to adjudicate disputes that were brought before him. Now coming towards the jurisdiction of Muhtasib. His jurisdiction extended to disputes like relating to wares and mayers, adulteration or fraud in merchandise or loans that were not disputed and yet which were not paid. What are the duties of Muhtasib? His duties included the prevention of nuisance, removal of obstructions from and encroachment upon public street. The Ain-e-Akbari does not mention the institution of Muhtasib, but there is no evidence that it was abolished either. It is important, however, that some of the traditional duties of Muhtasib were sometimes transferred to the Kotwal, who is the prefect of the city police. All cities and the townships had Muhtasib. Now I am moving towards the last topic of my discussion, that is appeals. After sifting through various sources, one cannot find precise rules of appeal as they exist today. What is clear is that the decision of the lower court was appealed to the higher court and then to the highest court. The last court of appeal was the imperial himself. Appeal against the decision of Qazi lay to the chief Qazi in the province and from there to the court of Sadr al-Sudur or Qazi al-Qaza of the empire. This was the appeal system for all the civil suits and criminal cases of a religious character. Now, I am coming towards the penal code of Aurangzeb Alamgir. Mirati Ahmadi or History of Gujarat by Ali Muhammad Khan was completed in 1761. It is an excellent book, and even the harsh critic of Mughals, Sir Judhana Sarkar, calls it a very authentic book. It is considered to be the most authentic description of their legal and administrative rules because it is based on state papers. It gives full copies of imperial farmans addressed to the officials of this province. One of the most famous farmans sent by Aurangzeb Alamgir to the Diwan of Gujarat on 16th June 1672 to give his penal code in a nutshell, means concisely. The whole farman cannot be given here, but some of their court personnel, their jurisdiction and appeal system are extracted below to understand the nature of judicial system in Gujarat, because the same was applied in the other provinces of the empire. So the first one is, the court mentions that all the serious criminal cases like theft, highway robbery and homicide are decided by the Qazi. Number two, in case of crimes for which punishment is not fixed in Islamic law, the court has the discretion to give the punishment of Tazir, means punishment for offenses at the discretion of the judge or the ruler of the state. Number three, if capital punishment was avoided by the Qazi, the person was put in the prison while the court was reported to the imperial for confirmation. Number four, cases of revenue were disposed of by the revenue officers. Number five, when a man was brought to the chabotra of the Kotwal under arrest by the police or the revenue collectors or accused by a private complaint, the Kotwal had to investigate the charge personally. He had to resort to court if there was a case against him. Number six, if there was a case of revenue department against him, the case had to be reported to the governor. Number seven, and the last one is, in cases where the punishment was not fixed in Islamic law and the Qazi had to exercise his discretion, the opinion of the Subedar regarding conviction, means punishment, or execution, means implementation, was very important for the Qazi. Moreover, he was personally dealing with the revenue cases. Thank you all of you for your time.